everyone to the State Farm Analyst Desk, where we have Detonation Focus Me facing a mighty foe and yet undefeated EDG. But there's quite a few ways, hopefully, a team like DFM can come out ahead. So we wanted to take a look at some options in what we're going to dub the underdog playbook, right? And DFM have been the underdogs before this year and have come out on top. So we wanted to take a look at a couple of ways they could do it here versus favorite EDG. I did talk to LGL expert Nymera, and I asked for some ideas. And he said, in terms of the meta read, he talked to Kazu, the coach, and he said, okay, DFM didn't have the best read on the meta. Specifically, the Pryo, Graves, and Yumi did not appear in their scrims at all. They'll have that fixed for this one, but where else can they look?
Well, it's also interesting because they went through play-ins, right? And yeah. So the meta in play-ins has not had not had a ton of...
juked.
Yeah, exactly. So I think if they're going to have a chance, I don't think that Evie's TP's bot side are a bad call, just because EDG is an incredibly bot lane focused team. So if you can somehow set them off kilter in that bot lane, obviously, Mako and Viper are, I think, the strongest bot lane at this tournament. So to try to set them behind, that's not a terrible option for win conditions for DFM. I do also think that if you're able to do that, it's then about like spreading the pressure around the map. So it'll be up to them with Ebi on something that he's really, really comfortable on.
When you talk about the bot lane, as you say, it's a tall order, right? Up versus this EDG bot lane. Gang has been a fantastic player, fantastic support all through the season for the side of Detonation Focus Me. But if you can't do anything or not get out of the lane, what are you going to get out of him, right? So I feel like Kadro, it's a bit of a balance for like, okay, we can't sack the lane, but what do we do instead?
To be honest, I think you could play topside early, like Emily was talking about, to get Evie a TP advantage and then use that towards bot side, because that's been like the one successful point for DFM, right? If you can't beat them 2v2, beat them 3v2, right? That's the only real plan you can realistically go into in an early game to actually get top ahead to translate that pressure to bot for maybe some kind of 4v2, right? Otherwise, getting him out of lane and going towards top and sacking bot can be a good plan if you put your AD carry on things like Ezreal or Ziggs that can just kind of sit back and wave clear.
Let's look at the mid lane too. We have Scout versus Arya. Arya, super hyped mid laner. I asked Nymera, can he play the things that have proven to be super, super strong, like the Sylas and whatnot? He says, yes. In fact, they are very comfortable playing around a roaming mid like Arai. So they should look at that and try to prioritize that. What do you make of that plan?
I don't think that's a bad plan. I also think that if you're looking at mid jungle, an interesting thing to compare is that, you know, I think Arya in some matchups should be able to stand up to Scout, despite the fact that Scout is an incredibly strong laner. And then Chieche, if we're looking at him, we've seen Steel be more willing to play stuff like the Talon, the Ghostblade junglers. I don't think that's JJ's style. If we look at what he's played, they've actually been one of the teams that have used the Jarvan really well. He plays Lee Sin. If you look at his most played, there's Udyr up there. So that's another thing, you know, maybe get him off of his comfort picks and towards more of these carry junglers that he might not be as comfortable with.
There's a lot of maybes here.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
And when I look at DFM in this group, they got stomped by T1, right? Yep. There's no doubt about that. 100 Thieves kind of dismantled them. There was no real way into the game. So DFM, I'll be just brutally honest on the desk here and just say, like, I don't think they can win this game purely based on individual skill, right?
Yep. The underdog.
However, we have seen best of ones go in favor of the underdog team for many different reasons, right? A level one lane swap from Gigabyte Marines against Fnatic, right? Mm. Take the game off them because you don't actually have to lane 2v2. Maybe late invading bot side, splitting the map 5-man level one, so they can't lane 2v2. These are the kind of things you have to come up with, or just some kind of crazy pick to catch the enemy team off guard.
Yeah, I like it. We've got the Hopium also over there. I think a lot of people would like to see them take a game, and maybe it's this one, casters. Let's get over to Freakazale and Lyric.
Thank you very much, Shox. I'm hoping for a fun and exciting game. I would love to have some more upsets here in the group stage. Mm-hmm. You know, I think if the last two games were upsets, I'd have a good time casting today. You know, I think I'm looking for that.
No upsets here, Freak. We want EDG. Just kidding. But it would be really cool. It'd be really cool if DFM are able to take this one. Again, just the story of LGL in general, right? Finally being able to make a group stage. Yeah. And sadly, just really looks like what Kadril said. Individually, they haven't really been able to stack up across the board. So especially seeing people like Steel and Arya be able to come out and do well against like Scout and JJ, or Evie being able to do well against Flandre, who has always been hot or cold in the LPL.
And I'm with Kadril 100%. You just have to take a swing. You have to do something crazy, whether it's strategic or pick-wise. They've been blown out two games in a row. You know, they got destroyed by SKT. They got destroyed by 100 Thieves as well. And EDG is obviously capable of doing similar things to them in a standard game. So, you know, you have to try to take a risk here, I think, as DFM. And being on the red side, you have the opportunity to look for some sort of counterpick.
There is already something that's different from the T1 game and the 100 Thieves game, though, is both of those teams spanned out LeBlanc, Irelia, and the Xin Zhao. So Xin Zhao will be left open. I don't know if EDG plan on first picking that one when you still have things like Lee Sin left open, the Twisted Fate. So DFM maybe will be able to get their hands on Steel's most played jungler in the LPL and get a bit more confidence on a pick he knows.
Could be fun to look at. Right now, Lee Sin has been locked in, so already Jieje is going to be ready to turn a lot of heads, kick people backwards. This is exactly kind of his style, so that's going to look fun. Let's see what Evie can do, you know? Camera's on you, Evie. Where's the thumbs up, man? Where's the thumbs up?
He's
missing an opportunity.
Free.
He's missing an
he's
opportunity.
He's trying to do a draft right here.
How hard is champ select, really? You know?
It's difficult.
Apparently, you just counterpick yourself in top lane a couple of times, and yeah, it is. Leona going to be grabbed. Not much of a surprise here. MF would be a very likely combo alongside that one.
Yep, I feel like that's the most likely, right? Unless we see something like a Sion Tristana come out, which could set up for that level one lane swap Kadra was talking about, but not too likely here. I do would like to see this Steel going back onto the Talon jungle. I'd say it has looked mechanically proficient on it. Some of the decision making has been a bit weird. I remember especially in their game yesterday answering a play bot. I believe he was the one who took TP on the champion. So maybe higher execution able to come out, really good team fighting. For the side of EDG though, they're keeping it very stock and standard.
Man, you already have multiple reveals there for the Talon ulti, the Lee Sin E, the ulti as well from the TF, so not a lot of safety to actually be gained in that.
Yep.
And it's interesting to see MF actually go undrafted here for that through that first phase.
Yeah, they really, really had high priority on Talon and wanted to make sure they could answer mid lane on three. And they thought, look, we can't let Talon go to the second ban phase, whatever, we'll deal with AD carries otherwise. And on the other side, EDG clearly valuing the Jace very highly as well, knowing, hey, they're on blue side, they got to blind something. Get it in before the bans can come through.
This is also very stock and standard for EDG. They have one of the highest counterpick rates for both AD and support in the LPL. At this tournament so far, both games they saved AD and support 4-4-5. They play pretty much every type of bot lane, whether it's all in, whether it's enchanter supports, whether it's like wackier things like fasting bot lane. So I feel like this is right at home with EDG. And it looks like DFM want to go toe to toe. Potentially, you would expect, you know, get an aggressive AD carry there with the Leona to look for some all ins.
Of course, first dibs go to the LJL squad of Detonation Focus Me, so leaving up the highest tier, which generally speaking for most teams looks to be Misfortune. So the Draven is off the table as one of the possible answers. I've seen Karthus named as one of the other MF answers. We don't see him.
Yeah.
But, you know, you get an on-demand slow that's undodgeable, and it's like, what's your moves going to do when you're slowed 80%?
Senna as well. I know some players have been talking about Senna. Danny, someone who's been playing a lot of Fleet Footwork Senna and having success with that. So always interesting to hear about some of those different picks. But Flandre kind of protecting him on that top side. A couple of bans thrown over towards Eva here.
So yeah, we're going to get the Jhin coming out for DFM, so not wanting to opt into the Misfortune. We haven't seen a lot of Jhin into the Misfortune, so does bring strong laning. We've been seeing a lot of like control around the map coming out with both the Snare and the Ultimate. And now for EDG, I'm surprised to see them wanting to go towards something like the Ezreal if they do decide to lock this in. Again, they've been a lot more of a lane-dominant bot lane duo in the LPL.
But to be honest, at Worlds, we've seen kind of more roaming coming out from Mako. If he goes Braum, it's not really what I was expecting. But it would have made sense if you're playing, you know, TF plus Jace, you want to play side lanes, if you wanted to get out of there and roam, well, Ezreal's a great pick to do that. But, of course, it does look like it's going to be the Braum. So we'll be probably playing, you know, more just as an answer, it feels like, to the potential Jhin.
Still does set up nicely for the 1-3-1, right? You clearly have the score that's going to sit in the mid lane with Ezreal, Braum, and Lee Sin. You have your two side laners. You're going to hopefully look to make picks, kite out, play from a distance using things like the Glacial Fissure. And now for DFM, it's all about looking for these aggressive engages.
Poppy,
we got Poppy
in. So Poppy, Jace, this is a matchup where theoretically you're getting pushed in early game, but you really consistently have lethal threat. It is not that hard to find a decent wall slam, but the damage output is really high. Poppy can be the setup for Talon to finish the kill, and it's one where you lose pressure and then suddenly kill the guy and take the lane over.
And this is another one of those games where you just stack armor. You're not really worried about the magic damage from TF when he is that only source of that. So, you know, potential here for Evie to get very, very tanky, especially early game when you're looking at the Jace plus the Lee Sin. The early armor is going to be really, really powerful here. See if he can hold on in what is still going to be a very tough early lane. And if Flandre does get way ahead, then the scaling kind of matters less. So you can get run over.
I also feel like the only other thing I don't love about the Poppy is when we've very clearly seen EDG draft this composition that doesn't want to fight and just like fine keeping at arm's length and cutting back. Sadly, Poppy doesn't really do anything to lock you down, keep you in the fight. You're looking to like maybe flash in and just pop the quick ult to knock you up, but that is extremely unreliable. So don't know if we can expect that one. And yeah, it feels like both teams kind of looking at different things. For DFM, it's mid jungle. For the side of EDG, you're definitely looking a lot more towards that top side with Flandre, which is a far cry from what they did in the LPL.
Well, here we go. Detonation Focus Me hoping for a somewhat of a birthday present for Aria. Technically in Germany, it's not yet, but in his home country of Korea, or even in his home league in Japan. It is his birthday. It is October 14th. So for the home crowd, happy birthday to Aria. And maybe he gets a win over Edward Gaming, the LPL champions. What a present that would be.
I was going to say, I don't feel like you can have a better birthday coming out. And I mean, if that did happen right, they would exit the week 1-2. So still very doable to be able to try to find their way to make it out of this group stage. And yeah, it feels like they have a lot of champions that are very volatile, can make this very skirmish heavy, and EDG have never really thrived when it gets a bit too chaotic.
Fair enough.
Yeah, I mean, they're a team that just loves to play through objectives, right? And that's always what they are focusing on, setting up around objectives. I think their team fighting is the best in the world. You know, they are so proficient at kiting back, at always staying spread out. You know, they kind of have this little line where they kite back into the semicircle, and anyone who gets attacked on the team, the other members collapse in, take them out. It's really, really impressive to watch how they position in team fights and how they work together. And they're going to have a lot of poke here and the ability to kind of perform and replicate a similar thing in this game here, too.
I think that's the good thing, right? Talking about the poke, the fact that Viper, if they do get to that mid game, will be able to have a massive impact. Viper definitely the standout, by far, best AD carry in the LPL. This split, no one even close. But it will take him a bit of time to get there, so DFM will have those opportunities available. And, you know, the thing I'm most curious in seeing in this early game is if DFM are going to put any stock into trying to, like, relieve pressure from the Poppy, help him get through that early laning phase, and then maybe try and combo up with it, you know, once it does get a few levels under its belt.
I mean, it's definitely possible if Steel is clearing from bot to top, you know, head up there. If the Jace doesn't have the wave properly bouncing towards him at that time, maybe Steel can look for some sort of a play, but... You know, we are seeing Lee Sin clear the same way, so JJ can definitely look to answer that, and Lee Sin plus Jace would be a powerful 2v2.
Interesting choice here. Scout learning the stacked deck at level 1 for the most aggressive pushing possible. It is easily the most minion damage you're going to get from a skill point at level 1. Says, okay, I'm going to make sure I'm getting 2 first. I'm going to have this control over the Silas over here in the mid lane, but as Aria gets level 2 himself, comes in for a pretty decent trade. Yeah, lands both halves of E and Q.
And just really nice trade coming out from Aria. Scout playing this so aggressively. Again, you really don't see the start come out in this matchup all too often. Steel looks like he wants to capitalize, though. Is it being spotted?
Forward, here he is. Scout at half. Doesn't quite guess the flash E. Scout still flashes as he was afraid, but doesn't land the stun. And now actually takes the better half of the trade as Aria gets pushed down to 120 health.
I actually really like that, you know, being able to circumvent this ward. You know, there's that ward in the pixel brush, and he just hops over the wall so he can attack from a different angle. And yes, the chains did not connect there from Aria, but a nice little try. You have to get cute with these plays. You have to try to find some sort of advantage here against EDG. And Steel trying to use some clever pathing to do that.
It's also nice that they realize like what their early game win cons are, right? They have mixed damage in the mid lane. They have the setup coming from the Sylas for the burst from the Talon, and trying to look for those aggressive plays. Again, it was a bit of an execution there, not just predicting Scout's flash correctly, but I like the attempts coming out. If Steel wants to make his way to getting a Scuttlecrab, would have to make his way down towards that bottom half of the map, but you look at the laning phase, he did have 3 lanes of Pryo, so not too much Steel is able to do at this point in time.
He's pretty happy. Go ahead and knock down that ward as well. Bit of extra golden experience. Heavy just holding up in farm. And honestly, this is fairly reasonable for Poppy, right? You're down 1 CS, you're doing okay. Your health bar is all right. You still got a crafting potion stack. That part's going okay. It's just, yes, the priority is there, right? The safety for the Lee Sin to do whatever he wants on the top side of the map.
Exactly. And he's going to be able to get the scuttle on the bot side as well. So that huge line of vision across the river. And we can see Steel moving in here, trying to find some sort of a play on Scout who doesn't have that flash. But of course, the control ward will spot it.
And right now, not losing any time, right? Doesn't have any camps up. Doesn't look like his Gromp will come up soon. So maybe can see something like a recall come through. But right now, actually, you look at the mini-map, he's making his way towards the top side. Flandre is pushing, so could set up an opportunity for Steel to find something.
Okay, red buff on. Can Flandre survive the 1v2? Tackles into a minion to get the slow. Now a flashback, but the damage still going to be landing for the auto attacks. That should burn him down. No, the potion! The potion's enough! Oh. And he's going to survive with Summoner down. TP still up, means he's getting back into lane at full health.
Man, I think they thought it was dead completely. They didn't take into account the biscuits there, the potions that could come through, because Evie still had his flash. He could have flashed in for another auto that would have guaranteed the kill, but I think he thought Steel already had it, and he didn't need to, and now they're looking for a dive mid.
Looks like they think the damage is high enough as Scout forces Arya off the wave entirely. It's like 800 health left in the health bar. Level 5 Lee Sin could have finalized it, so a little bit of poke and nothing else. Most of this wave is going to be denied. 38 to 22. Off the TPs, it was like 5 CS apart. Now, it's 17.
Yeah, this is just really rough. I mean, we've seen the ideas of what DFM wanted to do, just a few flubs here and there. And EDG, they're just taking it slow. They're winning naturally through lanes. Their bottom side has been pushed, and not really a whole wave up, but half a wave up. Scout doing such a nice job. They denied some experience from Arya there on that play as well, so Scout will be able to hit 6 first. It's going to set up a window to where he can make a Destiny play, to where typically the Silas would be able to react, but now he will not.
Gonna try here. Now again, level 6 is in for TF, but not anyone else. Mako coming around, spotted actually by Steel, so they know they've got an enemy support, but now he's far enough away. You can maybe go for the try. Yes, they're gonna look. They know he's flashless. They gotta land the stun, and they will do so. They gotta get the damage over, and yes, happy birthday, Arya, first blood.
Nicely done, and Steel, I think, is actually playing a really good game in these early minutes. Goes mid, forces the flash there, up towards top, forces a flash there, back to mid, gets the kill, while Scout still doesn't have that flash, so Talon paying some dividends here early on. They are still unfortunately down because the lane difference is pretty big.
I feel like a lot of what you're saying as well comes down to the point you hit on earlier about the ward he dodged out.
Yeah.
Even in that play, going to that brush, ignoring the camps he had up, I think EDG maybe expecting he wouldn't be there. He would be farming maybe his quadrant of the jungle and just doing a nice job of taking advantage of these unexpected plays coming out. But speaking of plays, EDG have a wave stacked in topside. Can they find it?
They're looking 3v1 top. Who's going to join them? No TP available. Goes for a little bit of time. Nice ulti charge. Sends them both back. Evie showing us how it's done.
I mean, you love it. That is what you pick Poppy for, to deny those types of plays coming out. And Evie even going to look to brawl with Jinx and not going to let him get these
Krugs. Krugs. He's forcing the smite, though, so Big Krug is taken. And may have to respect Lee Sin. As you can see, the top wave is now dying to the turret. The first plate is grabbed as well. Okay, you lose 3 CS, you lose a plate, but at the very least, you wasted some of TF's time.
I even like what EDG are doing on the bot side in reaction to this, though, right? They realize that, hey, because we're wasting so much time on top side, Steel can make his way into our jungle and look to take some of our camps. So Mako and Viper just go and take the red buff themselves, not going to allow that to be taken away, and also going to give them a lot of power in the trades in this laning phase.
The wave goes down, level 6 comes fairly soon for the bot laners. That's what we're going to watch for soon.
And we'll see what they can get done next. I would love to see Steel try to get back up towards this top lane, punish Flandre on this missing flash. Was able to make it happen with Scout, and the fact that Scout now doesn't have the TF ult means they don't really have an easy response to a sort of gank up there. So we'll see if he can circumvent some of these wards. There are a number that they have actually kind of defending the Jace up on this top side. You can see 3 wards along here, so it would have to be a bit of an oddball path to actually dodge all the vision.
Still does feel like the fact that Flandre doesn't have the flash, we see Arya actually has the Destiny Gate available and Gang has made his way up towards the top side, should potentially give DFM the option to take away a blue buff, look to start a Rift Herald if they so choose, and EDG probably not in a position to answer, though Mako and JJ are making their way up.
The lane is awkward for Flandre, though. He's got no mana, really, and no TP, so he kind of needs to stay to protect the wave and get that pushed in, but also the rest of DFM are right in that river, so if he goes too far up, you know, Gang and Arya show up and the man dies, so they're gonna be able to grab the Herald. Yes, indeed. I was worried about a chance this might not gonna happen. Steel and Arya should be able to jump over the wall, so it might be a safe retreat, but hang on. Does Gang get slowed? Is it gonna be much of a follow through? No. Wave safely pushed in, so Flandre gets what he needs out of that wave, but still, DFM not only have first blood, but they got the first Herald.
DFM are playing a great game, honestly.
Yeah.
They're playing EDG pretty tight here. Yes, it is only the first 9 minutes, but this is by far the best early game that they have been able to actually turn in. A lot of clever little bits leading towards that play. Obviously, the gank towards top. Evie sees that Flandre is low on mana, so he takes some damage to actually get up there and delay the base, so Flandre had to stick around. And EDG can't really contest with an Jace coming in. He doesn't have TP either, so he couldn't reset in time. So smart stuff here, and while Steel was spotted out by the ward, the pink ward has now been cleared out, so there is always the possibility that he could look to try to sneak up around.
And I think, you know, with the clever plays from DFM, also EDG looking to go for the Herald contest despite what you're talking about with Jace, despite the fact that Mako's so behind on Roam Timer, that is just very standard in the LPL. Our teams do not know how to avoid the Rift Herald fight, but Engage coming out from Gang.
Decent damage. Guardian helping a ton, though, means Viper gets to block about 120 of that damage at this point in time, and not gonna hurt too badly. Gang should be able to grab the melee minions here and get the cash back in.
Just gonna be slow in standard for now, seeing if they can just get a bit of trading coming out. Yutapon wanting to make do with the burst in the fourth shot that he has, but not able to find it.
It is looking like it's kind of EDG's turn to maybe make a play on the map again, as Scout does once more have the ultimate. It'd be interesting to see if they want to go up towards Evie again, because he had a great response to that TF ulti. His Poppy's ulti as a response to it was fantastic, and if you can get that timing, just reject the TF right as he arrives, at the very least it will buy you so much time. And Steel heading over here.
Okay, Aria gonna take a bit of damage, but JJ pushed on a half HP, stun comes in on a scout, and that is a stolen Lee Sin kill.
Oh,
that's gonna be in second!
Let's go!
Oh my word! Jungle mid diff for the LJL squad. Detonation, focus me on the board!
When did Faker arrive in the mid lane there? Aria has the birthday buff. I've heard of the wipe buff, but this is a new one.
That's the thing, right? Freak was talking about a birthday present for him. Aria giving himself a birthday present. If they will be able to keep up this momentum and find the win, EDG looking to be the aggressors now.
Finds a stun. JJ forced to flash away. Flash dodges Flandre's damage, and Evie's here. That means it's time to get away. It's going to be a tough one to go in. Here comes the stun onto the wall, and Flandre has been flayed. JJ's next up. A quick point
and
quick stun. Scout flashes to safety, but Steel wants in. Not going to get any more, but DFM are 4-0.
Yeah, and EDG were the ones, the aggressors in that play. They went for that. Yutapon still down in the bot side. Viper had to make his way up, but none of it mattered. Didn't matter who was there. We saw the ultimate coming out from Gang, locking them down. Evie finding the knockup as well, and just set up for massive AoE damage coming out from the town.
And we can see in the new Axe Effect replay here, they just had no idea that Steel was there. They go in for the initial engage, and the stolen ultimate kick flash from Aria. What a play by him. And Steel has been so clever with his pathing, and now we can see EDG is looking to re-engage because Scout's respawn timer is 1 second and he had the TF ult. So they're saying, all right, just play it slow. Scout will arrive and we can win this out. Gang is pretty low on HP, but the ulti comes in. Evie gets the pin on the wall. Flandre is dead before he even arrives.
That's the thing, right? Flandre flashed into that. Flandre flashes in, immediately gets pinned down. Now you're kind of like cut up as a team, Scout on one side, Braum on the other, and it just leads to DFM being able to find the fight. And I think with DFM having an advantage, looking forward, we're talking about, hey, how do you really consistently engage on the side of EDG? Sure, you have the Leona, you have Jhin ultimate, but I think you'd like a bit more. If they're ahead, they're on objectives first. EDG are the team walking into them.
And the fact that they're doing this at all is impressive. There is so much pedigree on EDG. Scout is a 3-time LPL champion. Mako's a 4-time LPL champion, an MSI champion. He won Asia Games a few years ago, right? At an Olympics level competition. For DFM, even for the Korean imports, I put that in quotes, by the way, because their only league for Aria and Gang has been the LJL. They're basically just native Japanese players as far as the only pro they've played. First time in the group stage, they're crushing everybody. Here comes the first kill, here comes the second. JJ running away under his turret, and yes, he will survive, but it's a 5-0 game for DFM.
Man, Steel is playing out of his mind on this talent. He has been everywhere this game, across the map, finding plays, finding kills, clearing out vision, utilizing the Talon to have these really intelligent gank paths to come from different angles than EDG are expecting, circumventing their wards or making them just not really matter because he's showing up so quick.
Steel has definitely been having a phenomenal gank. Let's also highlight gank for the fact that He's just consistently been right behind him the whole time. They've been doing a nice job of getting vision. You look at the minimap right now, there's pretty much wards littered everywhere for the side of DFM. Anywhere JJ goes, DFM will know, and they can kind of circumvent, make their plan depending on that. Looks like Reset's coming out, going to make their way down towards the bottom side of the map. I wonder if they'd want to opt into something like a Dragon when we will have second Rift Herald soon. And as we've seen, a lot of teams definitely preferring the gold trade over the Dragon stacking as of late.
Waiting for it, because we're 14-10 in, and yeah, no one's even looked at the Dragon so far into this game. Bot lane is kind of clearing back and forth, like, hey man, Yuttapon's just hanging out. All right, he's just chilling. He's been on this team so long. He was on this team before the LJL even existed. Like, he's just been here, he's seen it all. Finally on his first world group state, and he's like, I'm just farming on Jhin, like everyone else getting kills. Like, this is great. This is what I wanted. Get me teammates as good as me. Let's win this way.
Yeah, I mean, it's looking good. You look up towards that top side, the Jace is down on farming the Poppy. Evie has the kill and the assist as well. And when you fall behind as Jace against an armor stacking tank, It is sad. You do not do anything. And even if JJ gets up there, I don't know that they actually have the damage to take down Evie whatsoever.
Yeah, you're definitely not going to be doing anything until you at least have something like a Sereltus Grudge later on in the game, but we are nowhere close. Eclipse and Evie looking for the 1v1 again. He does so much damage.
There is the Eclipse Power Spike, though. That does change things around a little bit nicely. Time gets rid of the To the Skies, and yeah, he's going back to the ground real fast.
Yeah, that was risky for Flandre. I think that Evie thought someone was behind him, because when you get that stun, he could have just done the point blank ult. He's going to go for it now.
Spark ult, it means it's slow. Red buff going to mean more as well. Point blank ulti. Wants the solo kill, not going to get it. And now it might be JJ getting the kill. Waits it out. That's going to be a dash back. It doesn't matter. Gets the kill. On the board finally is EDG, as Steel can't turn one around.
I mean, you finally find something, but still, that was cutting it extremely close for Flandre. One or two things go different. Flandre can get solo killed there. Sure, he traded back, but EDG get on the board. We'll celebrate that. A small win, but DFM still being the team to hold control. They got the first Dragon only a moment ago. They have their bot lane on the top side of the map if they want to look to start this Herald. And it looks like that's exactly what they're going to do for now. EDG looks like they're just going to look to funnel gold and Viper and hope that later on he can get to more power spikes to carry.
Yeah, and that's not very unrealistic. Viper could do some crazy things in the team fights. This guy is a walking highlight reel, but DFM going to be able to grab another Herald here, and we'll see where they want to put it. I think, you know, mid is the guaranteed kill, but going through top would make a lot of sense there as well if they think that they can finish off the mid lane turret easy enough later on.
Evie Haki probably should have taken that ult, by the way, just to make Viper take aggro and stop the shots in the turret. Really minor thing, doesn't matter too much. Herald pretty much instantly summoned in mid. Has to take the walk over, but as long as someone walks in a range, they'll get the gold. Yuttapon, by the way, is going to be out of local turret gold range, so a lot of gold sacrificed there. Actually, 400 gold missed via no one actually walking all the way up to the turret. That said, they guarantee the 150 bonus gold does not go Viper's way. Doesn't get his own first turret gold. Are you going to knock down top?
I also really like the fact that DFM, you know, other than the fact that it was low, took mid turret, for the fact that we hit on how EDG's comp wants to play out more through side lanes. And with the fact that DFM have that mid turret down, that they are just ahead, they can continuously push out mid. And it's going to make it really hard for Flandre and Scout to overextend in the side, or DFM can just constantly look to collapse.
Yeah, absolutely. And as long as Arya can continually steal away Scout's ult, he can match those plays, even if Scout wants to go towards sides. You know, Evie just has to kind of buy time in that type of situation. And as you said earlier, Gang has been so active on the map, has been very effective at actually finding these plays, and EDG is very low on actual hard engage. You know, they pick the more defensive support instead of looking for something aggressive, so they are reliant on poking down their opponents, then trying to go in for some sort of a play, unless they can find an odd number play in a side lane. So it'll be interesting to see how they make this happen with a deficit.
Take stock of the game, though. We were very hyped about the beginning of the game, but the gold lead has shrunk down below 1,000. Asterisk with the fact that TF prints 4 gold per CS, so there's 600 gold in the scoreboard that's just from a TF passive that doesn't really explain, like, good plays or wave control. It just kind of comes in, so you still feel like DFM are leading, just maybe not by as much as they were before. Edward Gaming very slightly pulling back into this one.
I feel like one thing we've seen this game so far, right, is that DFM have definitely been the better team, EDG have just been the better laners. Not necessarily like individual players, they've just been better in terms of like actual laning. So that's how they've been able to keep up the advantages so far. DFM though, again, I still feel like they're in a really good spot. They have some solid power spikes coming out with things like the Gore Drinker, Serrated Dirk on Steel as well, and Everfrost for Arya. So they're definitely in a position where they can take a fight.
Yeah, they totally are. And I mean, all things being equal, I think most people would still take EDG to win this because of their pedigree, because of how good this team is. But DFM are in an incredible spot, and the fact that they are slightly ahead in gold, you know, even though it is just slightly approaching 20 minutes, means they're playing a hell of a game. And it's been really fun to see, and I hope they can keep it up because it has been very, very exciting.
I do feel like this is a win-win for everyone, though, as JJ walks into Evie.
Yeah, doesn't guess the timing on the Q, so that's going to be the first little bit hit. Now going for movement speed, channeling the ultimate, and they're just going to run away. If he gets to hold it, he gets part of the cooldown back, so indeed gets two-thirds of it away. Still, though, top lane turret under fire, and it's going to be 2-2 in the turret score. Next dragon spawns in 30 seconds. If JJ runs right now, he can get there in time to fight for the dragon. Otherwise, I feel like DFM should be able to stack their second of that objective.
Yeah, you would expect for EDG to start making their way down towards that side. DFM are the team that already has control. But going back to my last point, the win-win, it's either DFM gets a win, that's cool, that's spicy, or hopefully on the opposite end, if EDG do win, hopefully it's all about a Viper highlight reel, because that would be really cool to see. So, you know, viewers, winners in the end.
Mm-hmm. I always liked that, you know? That's the fun thing about watching the game, is I see a victory screen every single game I cast. Except at Worlds, where there's exactly one team I'm rooting for, you know, in some of the games I'm casting. So, you know, sometimes let down, but here we go. In this one, I get to see a victory screen no matter who wins. Dragon is going to be claimed indeed. It was EDG playing for topside as JJ and co. took a red buff. They took most of this Raptor camp, Crux as well. So though a dragon was claimed, there's also about 300 gold kind of siphoned out of Steel's jungle.
Yeah, not too concerned about that second dragon just yet, but it is going to be Infernal Soul, very powerful on this comp. You know, honestly, Infernal Soul can really be annoying even when it's just on tanks. Like the a bit of added damage for something like a Poppy versus Jace matchup can really make it more threatening. And I do think we're going to see EDG start to play towards this next dragon. They just want to try to get as many items as they possibly can. You can see the two Muromanas, you know, stacking up there, trying to get those completions, I think, before they fight. Because the double completion for Jace and Ezreal is going to be really impactful. They didn't quite have it yet.
I feel like it's also with what you hit on earlier, right, about the fact that Evie has accelerated, does already have the Bramble Vest, the Plated Steel Caps, the Frostfire Gauntlet. So as Flandre, it'd be nice to get that stacked up, as well as, again, hit things like the Serelda's Grudge to be able to deal with the Poppy.
I'm going to be interested to see where Evie goes as far as the itemization. I actually am a pretty big fan of Warmogs in a game like this. If you're playing in the side lane, you just step back, you regen to full after every wave. Jace can't really push you off and threaten towers. And as far as team fights, you just stand in front of your carries, tank every single Ezreal Q, every single Jace Q. You can really become very, very difficult for your opponents to deal with.
Yeah, I mean, especially with the fact that they really don't have the ability to burst you out, right? Again, Scout not offering any damage, Flandre and Viper's damage both coming over time.
As a question, is it, would you do it before Thornmail, or would you finish that first, then go Warmogs?
I mean, I think it depends on how worried you are about the sustain here. There is a fair bit of sustain on this team, so I think it's absolutely reasonable to finish Thornmail and then go third item Warmogs. I do think that Warmogs is actually going to get you more value than something like a Randuin's or a Deadman's in this kind of game, because you're not really that concerned about getting 100 to 0 killed. It's more about being whittled down, threatened over time in a side lane or at a team fight where you're being poked out.
Good to know. Well, speaking of being threatened over time, the gold lead has changed hands. Some of that, again, TF passive, technically the reason why it's happened. DFM have sort of earned more gold than EDG at this point in time, but again, it's still changed hands, and gang is just deleted. There's number one. Now it really is an EDG lead.
Evie
here on the flank, wants to get on the Viper, can't get him though, kick back, a knock him as well, Steel nearly dies, and Arya may just do so. Evie shuts two back, a flash to safety, barely Arya will survive. We can see now that Edward Gaming is winning the team fight.
The poke coming out from Viper and Flandre, hitting so hard. Gang, right in front of her eyes, then he's gone. EDG still going to be in position to take this turret, and their comp is so good at sieging, they should be able to guarantee this one. Unipawn, be careful.
They're going to go for the second tower. They just want more potentially here. No, going to back off now, but jeez, they just deleted the Leona. Taking control there in the mid lane, and EDG showing, you know, just how strong they still are.
EDG doing quite well. You would expect resets to be coming out right now, and EDG looking towards that top side of the map. DFM, though, do have tempo because they did just come off resets themselves, so they should be able to clear out some vision and maybe make it a bit troublesome for EDG to walk in.
But the game may have changed hands. We can see a 2,000 gold lead here, and EDG is to get back on the map. Say, you know what? As long as we can control dragons now, we're not worried about an Infernal Soul. And with the gold lead we have, that, you know, should be able to keep doing that for now. So I want to see their map movements, what objectives they control, and where they head.
And that said, you know, EDG really was fighting that 5v4, right? Because they killed Gang off before they really could get anything done on the side of DFM. So if I'm DFM, you still have to be confident about your team fighting. You want to look towards stacking Soul. I do think that's probably their best way forward in this game. If they start getting shy around dragons, it's going to be difficult for them to kind of advance the game forward.
Steel wants in. Gang gonna flash, and they're gonna find Lee Sin. Second Sun's gonna come through as well. Will he die is the question. Gordrinker buys a ton of time, and he's gonna stay alive. Jin opens up. They're gonna find a slow and a Mako. Could be the option. Stunned up and killed indeed. Pretty good timing here. Dragon spawning in 45 seconds. Evie's still around in the back line. Very tanky, not easily threatened. Are you gonna miss his stun though? Here comes the damage output, and Evie is finally gonna burn down. Kick comes in, and it's gonna be a cleanup crew. DFM forced to run, Utapon alone, but Scout is here, and the Scout's code means you leave no man behind. All of DFM are sent back to the Fountain, and it's time to claim the Baron.
Nice kiting coming out from the side of EDG. They buy time, Jinja joins the fight. Really sick kick to lock multiple people off. Now, like you said, Freak, they're getting the Baron, they're getting mid lane turret. They should be even able to secure the first dragon for themselves. EDG are taking everything.
Yeah, EDG team fighting strikes again here. I have to say, I felt like Utapon just held that ulti way too long. You know, he was sitting completely out of the fight, waiting to kind of find this perfect third and fourth shot, while Viper is just mopping up his entire team. And I'm not sure if he just misjudged the situation and thought they were going to run it over, and he didn't need to actually move forward and get involved in that fight. But after the initial pick, if Utapon had been more involved, maybe it could have looked a little bit different.
Now we're going to see, though, the vision control coming out from EDG. The fact that they have this Jace, I feel like it's impossible for DFM to be able to walk in.
Yeah.
They got the first two dragons for themselves, so it's not like they need to worry about EDG, like, soul point or anything like that, but still.
I mean, they don't need to worry about the soul, but that was really their only win condition, yes. It feels like, remaining. You're right. Down 7,000 gold, and it's more about the fact that this is probably the only way we can come back now.
Yeah, they're worried about the 7,000 gold lead. They're worried about the fact that Viper is online 204. The Cerulda's not going to be far away. And the fact that EDG now have entire control. Jinja, I think this is like his fourth time in a row taking away enemy Raptors. They just own this map now. Summoner's Rift belongs to Edward Gaming, and they're on the way to the 3-0 start.
Yeah, I honestly feel like the only way DFM have to, like, find a fight now is actually we're going to go into the replay, and Azale, this is a little bit crazy.
Yeah, it definitely was. I mean, the initial play looks very good for DFM, but they can't quite actually finish off JJ. Then Utapon, as the team is retreating, I do like the ulti, but watch how long he holds this. The second shot goes in, he kills Mako. He's still sitting here waiting for a third and a fourth shot. Well, Viper is getting out so much damage, and you're not even shooting it at low health targets where he could be looking for an execute. He just ends up essentially taking himself out of the fight. And then by the time he actually arrives, his team is already dead. And it did feel like Viper just had such a huge impact in that fight.
I gotta shout out JJ for a really dirty Lee Sin ult, because he got two knockouts with the kick. He got it through two other people. That is amazing. That is really outstanding. I'm always a huge fan of seeing that one come through. They maybe win the fight anyway, but it's still the icing on the cake. And now with the 8,000 gold lead, they are sieging top lane. 3,100 gold to the Red Bull Baron power play. Top lane tier 2 about to be joining in. Gonna be closer to 4,000 gold when it happens.
And you know, this is where EDG's composition thrives, right? All five enemies right in front of you, able to dish out that poke, doing so well in a siege scenario. You have two Baroned up cannons, so EDG are gonna be able to keep going with this and whittling them down, but the Poppy ultimate might be able to buy some time.
Nice by Viper. I believe he tanked it as the Arcane shifted. Wasn't able to walk far enough up to prevent his cannons from being shot out of the map and into orbit, but still, the rest of the squad is here to push it down. The cannons are back in range, and the inhibitor turret will fall. 28 minutes in, and you would be forgiven if you didn't think this game started 5-0 to DFM, because now it is pretty much all Edward Gaming as they knocked on the first inhibitor. 28 minutes in, they're ready to close this one out pretty fast.
Yeah, absolutely. Going to be pushing down mid lane. They have the waves prepped here, mid and bot.
going to be looking to just try to finish this one off. You can see the waves coming in, but Talon is actually looking for a flank here. One last desperation play potentially coming in from DFM.
Here we go, big play coming in, going to stun the front line, but Braum is in the way. Rampage picked up, that's the name LJL fans have seen before, but this time around, it's EDG making it happen. Viper on a killing spree, and a kickback not going to matter. Mako stays alive. Good snipe coming through for Utapon. A second kill coming through as well. The trap, I believe, is the reason that even happened. But you can see the fight still went well, 3-2 for EDG.
Still, with the fact that DFM have been on the back foot for so long, being able to pick up some kills, really nice for Utapon on the Jhin. EDG started it off so well that they kited out the initial engage. They find their first kill on the gang. Viper also some really nice mechanics with the flash to cleanse the E to be able to escape both Steel and Aria and output all the damage in the fight. And it feels like for EDG, if Viper can stay alive, they're gonna be able to take these fights no matter what.
Yeah, and it's just gonna get harder and harder to actually take him down. He has the stopwatch now. He's building towards that frozen heart where it becomes very difficult to actually burst out this Ezreal. One saving grace, they did force both of his summoners, so that is something, as he had just used the Arcane Shift forward when Steel came in on that flank, so he had to immediately flash to get out of there.
I also feel like the idea is right coming off of DFM, right? That it's like the last play they have available is looking for this flank coming out with Steel and Aria. The problem for them is they really don't have a lane that they can push to be able to guarantee of like, hey, I'm going to try and get behind the likes of EDG to set up this play. But if they can find that play once again, it is always available. With Viper's summoner spells being down, Steel and Aria's are as well, so it also will be a bit harder to close the gap.
9,000 gold and a base to kill. Middle inhibitor turret still alive, but locked at 1/3 HP. Won't regen past that point. And they're going to get ready to make this one happen. Now, next dragon spawns in 35 seconds. It wouldn't really be in the back of their minds. Doesn't have to be. Even if you somehow lose this fight, you're only giving away third dragon. You're not immediately, you know, getting aced into soul. So the risk of a bad fight isn't too high here. But they may choose to play it slowly. They may choose to wait all the way for the dragon spawn, claim that, and then go. JJ going to be stunned up, but gets out of the way. And Gang is almost going to drop, but just barely stays alive. True Shot Barrage comes through from Aria. Doesn't get a whole lot of damage done, though. And ultimately, DFM are forced right back out. Scout is here, ready to keep playing.
The thing is, DFM are just feeling the pressure overall, right? You look at topside super minions coming in, you just sit on the fact that Dragon's coming up. They know that they need to do something now if they want to have a chance.
Yeah, but with Gang in base and Ahri actually answering top, they just can't do anything. Viper lights up Evi, and now they can close in. You can see mid and bot already chunked out pretty low. These towers are going to go down fast.
There we go. Turret going to fall. And the inhibitor going to be next up on the docket. 30 seconds still for Evi to respawn. Yeah, not going to be a problem here. As now, mid lane can be attacked. Look, Scout makes his way over. That's going to be another turret down. And honestly, in a 4v5, there's no way you fight for this inhibitor. You get this one up away as well, and now you fight for the double nexus turrets. But as the waves come in, the 5v4 siege may be enough. They can end the game right here. Dragon's going to be ignored. The nexus is the target. Second turret falling, waiting for Evi still for 8 seconds. And health bars are too low to keep fighting. So EDG is going to walk it in. As DFM finally take the fight. They get the stun, but can they kill Lee Sin? JJ able to get out pretty easily. The root comes in, and down goes Steel. Looking for the fight still in the 4v5. Evi in the front line, quite tanky, but not gonna matter. Three more kills. Nexus falls. Edward Gaming 3-0.
And it feels great. A lot of people doubting EDG despite the fact that they were the LPL champion. Some people having more confidence in FPX, but EDG definitely looking like the best LPL team here at Worlds. And honestly, they're right up there with Damwon as looking like the two current best teams. So really excited to see EDG going forward.
Yeah, very impressive team fighting from EDG. It is the expected result at the end of the day, but it was not the expected path to the result.
No.
DFM had a very strong early game. Steel, I cannot sing enough praises for his early game play on the Talon. I thought that was so impressive, circumventing the early wards, forcing flash from both mid and top, re-ganking, finding kills, finding creative paths that gave DFM a potential path to victory.
Yeah, especially, I want to highlight Gang as well, right? We highlighted how much time he spent out of lane following Steel around and really setting up a lot of those plays. Sadly, in the end, it just feels like, again, the caliber of players and team that EDG is, which was just too much for them to overcome.
Five players the first time at the group stage. EDG, you got a laundry list of people who have international accolades, so well done to them for the win. Now we're going to take a quick break. On the other side, Shox, Cadrel, and Emily are going to break down that game.
magical power of the realm is a mystery. Like a guardian, it is with you always. Defending you, charging you, watching over you like... Actually, it's not magic. It's this Cisco network. The power behind every gank, every combo, every mind-blowing moment. At League of Legends World Championships.
Everyone to the State Farm Analyst Desk, where we are going to break down that win by EDG. Oh man, poor DFM. I mean, we talked about the underdog playbook possibly coming in for Detonation Focus Me. And to be fair, when we look at the draft, getting a good pick in the mid lane, a good read on the meta with the bot lane Jhin and a Poppy, you know. Emily, what did you make of it?
I love the UOL flair with the first Poppy play. That, you know, the thanks UOL for giving us this pick. But with this, I see, I mean, obviously EDG heavily prioritized JJ's Lee Sin. I did like, and I pointed this out prior to the match, that Talon has been something that Steel has gone for, and they've actually played around it really well, especially in play-ins. The last-minute Poppy pick isn't something that we've seen from Evie recently. I know, Kadril, you looked it up, and he hasn't played it since 2017.
Season 7, yeah.
Yeah, so, but to see him bring it out here, I thought was kind of a cool answer, even though it didn't end up working out.
I'll be honest, I think DFM kind of screwed themselves a bit in the draft when they gave away first pick Lee Sin to JJ, as Emily highlighted, and they go TF Jace on 2-3, and you don't pick your top laner on 3 because you have to match Sylas into TF, and then they ban away Set and Gnar. Irelia's already down, Urgot's already down, 4 top lane champions banned, and the enemy team has a winning jungle matchup and Jace TF, so they can just play hard for top side. So it kind of worked out. The Poppy weathered the storm. It was going quite deep in his champion pool to kind of pull it out.
Yeah.
And they got some early leads, but I think the birthday miracle kind of ran out for Arya.
Yeah, the question is, how much are you really giving up to, like, kind of be able to ban out the enemy, and what do they still get their hands on? But as you said, the early game, man, we were full of hope because it was honestly well played, and a lot of the micro movements and micro mechanics coming out of Arya and Steel really were great.
Yeah, cheeky little kick flash here from Arya, and I think that Steel's positioning was great. He was already there to match the mid jungle play straight away, so that's a quick kill. And then what happens is support jungle mid matching up together, just as Emily highlighted in the pregame, and then they move around the map, right? And this is where they get even more kills.
Yeah, I mean, and I really liked, we talked about, oh, how are DFM going to win? This wasn't, we talked about mid jungle, this wasn't necessarily how we thought it would happen, but I thought this was a very well played early game from DFM, given their composition. They felt like they really did know how they needed to play it. Because of, you know, as we're going to see in a little bit, when EDG's composition does come online, it's really difficult if Flandra and Viper remain untouched on that Jace Ezreal.
Yeah, Viper, Ezreal, playing Ezreal Braum into Leona lane, so they have a winning bot matchup, and he was just scaling the whole game long.
Yeah, and then I remember we were watching this, and we were kind of like, okay, an underdog winning, this would be great for DFM. You're like, please don't give Viper a kill. Whatever you do, be very, very careful. And I want to skip forward to the team fight in the bot lane jungle, where, you know, you see what the composition of EDG is designed to do, Emily.
Yeah, and I mean, you really don't want Viper to come online, although in fairness, it is only a matter of time. And because he's able to go untouched throughout this fight, it's, you know, the itemization comes in afterwards. Yutapon is, like, quite frankly, really distant. The fact that they pointed this out on cast too, the fact that he saves his shots, it just means that he is out of this fight for so long.
And then
JJ has the insane play. Viper is virtually untouched throughout. Flandra is also fairly untouched, and they're just able to clean up.
Is it happening? Is the first seed, and EDG being the first seed from the LPL, the champions, and they're playing so well? Emily, is it happening?
No, you just cursed it.
I refuse to believe.
I'm a KT fan, you know? I can't get too excited about anything.
I don't have that kind of power, or at least that's what I tell people. We'll be right back after this break to get you hyped up for the last game of the day, the last hope of the West, 100 Thieves versus T1.
UNA might go 0-6 if they lose. Oh no.